Hi friends, a very good morning to all of you. Welcome to this live session from the Gate Academy. Today we'll be having a small discussion regarding our transportation engineering subject from Gate point of view. Yeah, actually speaking, transportation engineering is a vast subject, right? See, it involves these chapters according to the Gate syllabus. See, geometric design of highway we are having, traffic engineering we are having, and the payment materials and the design and the geometric design of railway and airport. So these are the chapters we are having for our GATE examination from the transportation engineering subject, right? So you might have already gone through the syllabus and all. We know that there will be an average weightage of 10 marks in GATE exam from this particular subject, right? See, a weightage of 10 marks is actually not a silly, weightage, right? It's a significant weightage. So the importance of transportation engineering is not only the weightage, but also it is easy to score. It's an easily scoring subject. So if you're comparing with the other subjects which are having more weightage, you know the effort you have to put to get that 10 marks from this particular subject is comparatively less, right? So yes, it's true. The concepts are more or less simple compared to other subjects. But the thing is, they can ask the questions like anything. A variety of questions can be asked. Or they can simply use 2-3 words in the question so that the contest is going to change, the answer is going to be changed, and they will be giving all the options according to like what all mistakes that you can make during the exam. They will check that. And accordingly, they will set the options also. So even if the concepts are simple, don't take it as silly subject. It's a very important subject. They can easily make you, or they can easily deviate you to the other directions. Okay, so don't make mistakes while solving the questions. All the concepts are easy. Some concepts are tough also. So while attending the class, after understanding the basic concepts, then go to the tough questions. Directly don't go to the tough questions from this chapter, okay, from this particular subject. First, go through all the basics, study all the simple formulae, then go to the toughest formulae, then solve the tough questions, okay? Yes, of course, we are not having that much tough questions in GATE examination, only a few other, but after solving the easy questions, after understanding the concepts, you will be able to solve those questions. Trust me. If you are attending the complete session of our transportation engineering, you will be in a position to solve whatever questions they are going to ask. Okay? Trust me. Okay? So in this session, we are going to discuss the first chapter, geometric design of highways. And the remaining chapters we'll be seeing in the coming days. In this week, we'll be seeing the geometric design of highways only. Later, on a later date, you will be getting the other subjects. Other chapters also from this particular subject. Okay, so I hope everyone have joined. Sunil Sharma is there. Good morning. Debashish, good morning, Debashish. Mohar Sahu is there. Good morning, Mohar. Lokesh, good morning, Lokesh. So I hope you are preparing for your GATE exam very well. So one, all the best in advance. Yeah, one of my friend is there. Hello. Yeah, good morning. So yeah, we are starting with the geometric design of highways. If you are checking the syllabus, you can see one more hint before this geometric design. It's nothing but the highway development planning and all. It's just a theory concept only. Like what are the milestones happened in our highway development activities? Like, you know, IRC, Indian Road Congress, you might have already studied in your college, right? So when IRC has formed, so such milestones may be there. So that you have to go through, it's simply some theoretical concepts and some surveys, what we are doing and all. So it's just a matter of like some one page, two page theories only. So the main part and that part that what I've discussed now, that part is not that much important for GATE exam. But the first chapter, geometry design of highways, is one of the most important concepts for GATE examination from this particular subject. Okay, so I told you the transportation engineering will hold around 10 to 11 marks. You can expect 10 to 11 marks. Previously, they were asking just around 6 or 7 marks only, previously, till some 2015 or 16. But what happened in 2016, they have introduced a particular chapter, the geometric design of railway tracks and airport, right? See, actually speaking, the railway engineering and airport engineering is a vast, vast, vast chapter. But the thing is, we are having only the geometric design. So what do you mean by the geometric design? See, for highways also, we are having two designs. Geometric design we are having, as well as pavement design we are having. Geometric design means whatever we are seeing, see the dimensions and all, the width of the road, how much should be the site distance, how much should be the slope we are giving for the road, like that. The super elevation you might have already studied, we will be discussing in our coming sessions. Okay, so that is geometric design, what I can tell, like the physical features, what are the dimensions, that we call it as geometric design. And whatever there below the ground, the pavement thickness, what should be the thickness of each layer, those things we are studying in pavement design. What are the stresses happening? What are the temperature stress? What are the stress due to the wheels? That we are studying in the pavement design. So such pavement design we are not studying in our airport engineering and all. So that is an advantage for us. We don't have to study a lot of things to get this 10 to 11 marks. So since they have added that particular chapter, geometric design of railway track and airport, the weightage has been increased now by some 2 marks. Okay, so 2 marks you can expect from this last chapter. And the geometric design of highways, it depends from year to year, but at least average 3 marks you can expect from this first chapter. Okay, see, to score that 3 marks, you don't have to put any extra effort. Attend all the sessions of this particular chapter. Trust me, definitely, definitely, you're going to get that 3 marks. And whatever, even if it is a toughest question, okay, compared to other questions, you will be able to solve that question. So I hope everyone have joined. We can go to this chapter, right? Yeah, Abhishek, good morning, Abhishek. Sunil, good morning. Okay, so we are dealing with the first chapter, geometry design of highways. We have to study 3-4 topics under this particular chapter, geometry design of highways. The first thing is the cross-sectional elements. So what do you mean by cross-sectional elements? If you are taking a cross-section of the road, what all things we are seeing? That's it. The width of the road and the slope of the road, etc. Okay, so first I'm just listing out what all things we are going to study under this particular chapter. We are going to study the cross-sectional elements. Then we are having some site distances, very, very important for gate examination. The site distance you might have already studied in the college. You may be thinking that it is a simple concept, but for gate exam, they can ask you the questions in any way. Okay, don't think that every time they will give all the parameters and ask you to calculate. From the question, you should identify what actually they have asked. Okay, so there is high chance of making mistakes. So sight distance, under this sight distance, we are going to study our stopping sight distance. Then we will study our overtaking sight distance. There is one more term called as intermediate sight distance. Okay, so we will go through one by one. Okay, yeah, good morning, Teja. The class will be in English. Because I'm more comfortable in English, but don't worry, we will be using simple things only. See, everything is related to our day-to-day life, right? See, whenever you are going on the road by taking your vehicle, or you are traveling on the bus, whatever it is, you're seeing everything. What should be the width of the road? How many vehicles are coming? When the congestion is happening? Everything you're seeing in your day-to-day life, right? So that is the important, that's the beauty of this subject. You can correlate with your day-to-day life. So whatever we are studying, easily you will be understanding those things. Only difficult part is calculation. If you're understanding the tricks, if you're understanding the formula, it's easy, that portion also. Okay, so the class will be in English, but it will not be going to affect you. Okay, don't worry, easily you will be able to follow. So intermediate sight distance we are going to see. We'll discuss one by one. I'm just giving you the overview. Sight distance, then we are going to study some aspects of horizontal curve. So many things will be coming under this horizontal curve, such as super elevation is there, very, very important for gate examination. Super elevation is there. Then some setback distance we'll be studying. Setback distance. Then some transition curve is there. I'm just giving you some important things only. Remaining portions we'll be studying in our coming sessions. After horizontal curve, we are going to study our vertical curves. Okay, what is the difference between this horizontal and vertical? If it is on a horizontal plane, it is called as horizontal curve. If it is something like hilly portion, it is called as vertical curve. There are two types of vertical curves. One is the summit curve, and the second one is the valley curve. So regarding this also, we will be studying in our coming sessions. Okay, so these are the topics, important topics we are going to discuss. So maybe in this session, we will be discussing the cross-sectional elements and the site distances. Maybe till this topping site distance depends on our time. So we are having a 2-hour session today. So tomorrow again, you will be getting a 2-hour session like that. We will be covering the first chapter. Okay. Yeah. Hi, John. Good morning. This session will be for 2 hours. So later you will be getting the remaining also. One more thing, for all other subjects, if you're having any query, you will be getting the live classes timetable. So we'll be providing you can go through the timetable, and whenever some classes are happening, you can go through it and visit. Okay, so better subscribe the channel and click on the bell icon so that you will be getting the instant notifications whenever some chapters, whenever some subject is going on, you'll be getting those notifications instantly. Okay, so subscribe the channel and click on the notification button. So coming back to our subject, so these are the things we are going to discuss in our session. So let's see till whatever portion we can cover today. Remaining portions we'll be covering in the coming sessions. Okay, so we are going into our first topic, cross-sectional elements. Cross-sectional elements. So cross-sectional elements, I have already told you what you mean by this cross-sectional element. Nothing but whatever we are seeing on the road. See, the width of the road is there. Then some, see, you know, whenever a vehicle is going and if it is applying the brakes, finally it is going to stop and all, right? Because of the friction. So the friction is actually a cross-sectional element. And the camber, you might have studied the slope of the road. So those things are coming under cross-sectional elements. The important cross-sectional elements I'm giving you, remember those things. Many times they are asked for 1 mark. Okay. So the first cross-sectional element is nothing but the coefficient of friction. Coefficient of friction. Or you can simply write it as friction. We generally denote with the letter, small letter F, coefficient of friction. See, actually, what do you mean by this coefficient of friction? We know whenever a vehicle is applying the brakes. See, suppose this is our vehicle. A car is there. I hope looks like a car. So we are applying the brakes. So it is going to stop, right? So whenever we are applying the brakes, a frictional force will be acting against the direction of motion. So what is that frictional force? It is nothing but a coefficient into the normal reaction. I will discuss those things again while we are discussing this stopping site distance. Okay, so that frictional force developing is nothing but a coefficient of friction into the normal reaction developed. That coefficient we are calling it as coefficient of friction. Okay, so if it is in the longitudinal direction, what we have discussed now is in the longitudinal direction, whenever you are applying the brake, your vehicle is going to stop, right? So that is in the longitudinal direction. What do you mean by longitudinal? In the straight direction. So that friction, I can call it as coefficient of longitudinal friction. There is one more coefficient of lateral friction. So what do you mean by coefficient of lateral friction? You might have already studied. Whenever we are turning the vehicle on the curve, your vehicle will definitely have a tendency to go sidewise, right? You might have already experienced in your life. Whenever you are riding your vehicle on the curve, there will be a tendency for you to go outside the curve. So who is resisting that movement, or I can tell it as skidding technically. Who is resisting that skidding? Nothing but the frictional force from the side, right? So I can call it as coefficient of side friction. So there are two types of coefficients. The coefficient of longitudinal friction, coefficient of longitudinal friction, and coefficient of lateral friction. Or I can tell it as coefficient of side friction. The important thing regarding gate exam is what are the values of this coefficient of longitudinal friction and coefficient of lateral friction. Generally, for design purpose, this coefficient of longitudinal friction, we'll take it as 0.35 to 0.4. It doesn't mean that in the questions which they are going to give, always the value will be in between this. So in the gate exam, they can give you any value. Whatever value they are giving for the numerical questions, take as it is. We'll be seeing some numerical questions, some practice questions, gate exam, gate questions, everything we'll see. Then you will understand that. Okay. For design purpose, generally we'll take from 0.35 to 0.4. But for lateral, we are taking, so this is longitudinal, this is lateral. For the design purpose, the maximum value we are going to take is 0.15. It is very, very important. It's 2-3 times they are passed for gate examination for one mark. See, just by hearting a value 0.15, you're going to get one mark. A one mark can change your score and rank like anything. So don't take any topic as silly topic, because you may be thinking these are simple things. We have already studied in our plus two physics and all this friction, but it's not like that. Very important. So many basic things they are fast for one mark. Okay, so take care of those things that are our friction. Then we are having the undulations, or I can tell it as unevenness. So what do you mean by unevenness? You can note it down parallelly. What do you mean by unevenness? See, while you are riding your vehicle or you are going in some other vehicle, you might have experienced some undulations, right? You may not be going smooth. If it is a national highway and all, it's an important national highway, then the road may be smooth. Otherwise, generally in our village road and all, the road quality may not be that much good, right? Because of the improper maintenance and all. So sometimes you may be going something like this, right? Because of some undulations on the road. If the undulations is only a little bit, then it's fine. What if it is very high? Definitely it is going to give you some discomfort, right? Also, the driver has to reduce the speed. You may have to lower the gears. So the petrol consumption also will be high. So much of problem will be happening, right? So that undulations, minute undulations, we are calling it as unevenness. Generally, how we are going to measure this unevenness? We are taking a stretch of some 1 kilometer. And in that 1 kilometer, what is the cumulative undulations? See, at each point, maybe the road may be somewhat like this before. Okay. So at each point, we are having some undulations, right? And we are going to measure that. We are having some instruments. Using the instrument, we are going to measure that what is the cumulative undulations? What is the sum of these undulations in 1 kilometer stretch? Okay. The instrument we are going to use for this unevenness is nothing but the bump indicator. Very important. Note the name of the instrument. We are using the bump indicator. And using the bump indicator, we have started measuring from this point, and we are going through this road. And whenever the 1 kilometer stretch is ended, we are going to check what are this measured undulation value, the cumulative undulation value. That should be less than 150 centimeter per 1 kilometer. Okay, this cumulative value in 1 kilometer should be less than 150 centimeter per kilometer. Okay, if you are referring the textbooks, you can see some other values also. The thing is, it is for some good payment. For a good payment. So note down the unit. In case if they are asking in terms of some millimeter and all, it will be 1500 millimeter. Okay, so always check the unit. Yeah, very good, Abhishek. has already given this name, bump indicator. Very good. Okay. So these points you have to remember. I told you these are simple concepts, but can be asked for 1 mark. So the instrument name you remember and the value also you remember. Okay. So suppose if the measured value is more than 150 centimeter per 1 kilometer, what it indicates, see, don't think that it is 1.5 meters undulation. It's not like that. Cumulative value, suppose here some 10 centimeter or some 1 centimeter undulation only, then I am measuring and I'm adding that. That's what cumulative undulation. Okay. So suppose it is beyond our limit, what you have to do? We have to do the maintenance work. Okay. Otherwise it is going to affect you like anything. You will not be getting much comfort while riding and you have to lower your speeds. Definitely it is going to affect. Okay. So that is our unevenness. Then we are going into the one of the important concepts from gate exam point of view, that is nothing but the camber. Okay, so I'm going to rub this portion. I hope you have already noted down these things. So I'm going to write here. Camber is nothing but the slope that we are going to give on the road surface, right? You might have already studied, but see, from naked eye, we will not be realizing that there is a small slope on the road, right? It may be some minute slope only, some slight slope. It will not be that much high. That's why we are not, from the naked eye, you're not able to realize that there is a slope actually. It's nothing but a transverse slope, not a longitudinal slope. Suppose this is the cross section you're seeing towards the board. So this is the width of the road, and actually it will not be like this horizontal. Suppose this is your horizontal plane, the actual road may be something like this. Okay, it is called as that slope, that transverse slope is called as camber. So that is our next one, camber. Okay. So that transverse slope, see, for gate examination, even that definition is asked for 1 mark. What is the cross slope? It is nothing but the cross slope or transverse slope, I can tell. So the cross slope provided on the road is called as dash. They have given 4 options. One option was camber. Even the definition is asked for 1 mark. Okay. See, why we have to give a slope over the road? If it is a plain road, that is better, no? Why we have to give a slope? Just tell me, what is the necessity of giving a slope, a cross slope? What may be? Very good, Abhishek. Drainage purpose. Very good. See, suppose rainfall is happening. Yeah, good. Devashish, good. So if some rainfall is happening, it has to drain off to this side, right? It has to drain off to this side. Side drains may be there, drainages may be there. First, the water has to reach to the drainage, right? Yeah, very good, Uptal. Varun is also giving the answer. Very good. So that water, first it has to reach the side drains. Then only it can go, right? So first it has to reach there. That's why we are giving the camber. So that is also a gate question. Why we are giving the camber? It is for drainage. So all the important concepts of camber is asked in the gate exam. So can be asked again. Okay. And some numerical portions can also be asked in this camber. Some other theory concepts are also asked. I will give you that also. And some numericals also we will see. There is a chance they can ask a numerical question also from this particular concept. Okay. So what is the camber? This particular slope. So there are 2 concepts for this particular concept of this cross-section element camber. One is, what will be the height of this highest point? What will be this highest point? We call that crown. What do you mean by crown? The something we are putting on the head, right? So this we call it as crown point. So either they can ask you what is the height of a crown. So first concept is height of a crown. Either they can ask you that, or there is one more concept I will give you after some time. So first we will see this height of crown. So what is this height of crown? Nothing but this height, W. I'm just denoting as YC, height of the crown C. Okay. So depends on the shape, actually the equation of camber is going to change. If it is a parabolic camber, if it is a straight line camber, the equation of the camber is different, but the height of the camber is out of the crown is same. I'm telling it once again, a camber can be a straight line camber, which means these are straight line portions. This we calling it as straight line camber. So it can be a straight line or straight camber. It is a straight camber. And sometimes it can be a parabolic camber also. What do you mean by a parabolic camber then? This is our horizontal line. This is our horizontal line. Then it will be something parabolic. Okay. So it will be something like this. So this is parabolic camber. That is straight camber. Okay. Yeah. Good. Good. Already they are giving the reply. So suppose I'm telling the slope is 1 in n. So what do you mean by 1 in n? If you are moving n meters horizontal, you will be getting 1 meter vertical, right? So this is 1, this is n. Suppose that is the slope. Okay. So I'm telling if width of the road is W, width of the road is W, till this crown, what will be the depth? What will be the width? W by 2, right? For n horizontal, you're having 1 vertical, right? For n horizontal, you're having 1 vertical. Then for 1 vertical, you will be having 1 by n vertical. Then for W by 2 horizontal, how much you'll be having? W by 2n. Right? It is nothing but the height of the crown will be how much? Height of the crown will be W by 2n. What is that W? Nothing but the width of the road. I will write again. N is nothing but if the slope or if the camber is 1 in n, if the camber is 1 in n, suppose the camber is 1 in n. Then n means what? That in that equation W by 2n, n means what? The 1 in n. We can represent the slope either in terms of percentage or in some decimals or in 1 in n term, right? So parabolic camber, there is an equation for parabolic camber. If I'm taking a distance x from here, so correspondingly, I'm just telling that is y. There is an equation for parabolic camber. Y will be equal to 2x squared divided by nw. That is a standard equation for any horizontal distance x. The height of the camber will be 2x squared divided by nw. But we are interested in height of the crown. Height of the crown means what? Height of crown. What is the distance of x? X will be equal to w by 2, right? Crown means what? At the center portion. So if the total width is W, this is our Y of crown. So till here, what is the X distance? W by 2. Remaining portion is W by 2. Like that. Okay. So X is W by 2. If you are substituting the value of W by 2 in this X, you're going to get YC. What it will be? 2 into W by 2 square divided by NW, right? So if you're calculating what you're going to get, so just check it. If you're substituting W by 2, what you're going to get, just check it. You're going to get W by 2n, right? The same equation you're going to get for height of camber, if it is a straight line camber or parabolic camber, okay? There are some disadvantages for that shape, straight line, straight camber. Yeah, very good there, Bashish. For parabolic camber also, we are having some disadvantages. Okay, so practically we are giving a combination shape of this straight line camber and parabolic camber. See, what is actually the disadvantage? For gate examination, they may not be asking, just for your information, for your knowledge, I'm telling. Straight camber is actually will affect the fast moving vehicles. See, fast moving vehicles means they have to overtake, right? Just assume here what it is there. Some corner, some pointer shape on the center of the road, right? See, just imagine you are going in your car, one auto rickshaw is there, you want to overtake. Whenever you are overtaking, you will be using the center portion of the road, right? What if there is a pointed shape like this? Definitely you are going to get some discomfort, right? So higher, the faster moving vehicles will be having some problem on straight roads, straight camber roads. What is the problem for parabolic camber? If it is a parabolic camber, it is good for high speed vehicles, right? there is, it's a smooth curve. So easily you can overturn and all, you'll be having much comfort. But the problem is for parabolic camber, here it is having more slope, right? See, which is having more slope means more slope in the sense in at the edge. If it is a straight line camber, the side is right like this. If it is a parabolic, it may be something going like this, no? So more slope at the edge is happening for a parabolic camber. So for slow moving vehicles, there is a chance that they may be coming out of the road towards the inner side, they may topple. Okay, so this is disadvantage for high speed traffic. This is disadvantage for slow moving traffic. Why slow moving traffic? This is advantage. It is having some more slope compared to straight line at the edge portion. Okay, at the edge portion, it is having some like something like this. So if a truck is there, something like that, truck is there. So some small slowly moving vehicle is there. There is a tendency, there will be a tendency for those vehicles to come towards the inner side of the road. Okay, so that's why practically we'll be using the straight line camber and the parabolic camber. Okay, so remember that equation W by 2N, very, very important. They can ask you some numerical questions for that. Okay, now see, most of the time they may be giving you the value of W. What is the width of the road? Suppose if they are not giving you the value of the road, sorry, the width of the road, you have to substitute that. So IRC, Indian Road Congress. IRC is giving, you know, IRC is giving all the specifications for, right? What are the rules you have to obey? What are the specifications? What are the values you have to take for each parameter? Everything IRC is only giving us, right? So according to IRC, there are some minimum value of the width of the road. If it is a single lane road, how much should be the width? If it is a two lane road, what I mean by two lane, vehicle will be going in this road and one more lane will be there. So if it is a two lane road, what is that? Generally national highway, definitely it will be two lane or four lane and all. What is four lane? One direction here, one direction here, one direction, right? There will be some separations. Practically we call it as median and all. We'll see that. Okay. So in case if they are not giving you the value of W, then we have to take those values which are given by IRC. Okay. So Debashish is asking whether we have to refer IRC for examination purpose. Yes, actually you have to refer, but it is not possible to refer all the parameters, right? That's why we are giving the class. Okay. All the important parameters that is required for the examination, everything from minute portion to the toughest portion, we'll be discussing here. What are the values we have to remember? Yes, I'm going to give you those IRC values for W that you have to remember. Okay, so all the important parameters, IRC is actually giving lot of specifications. All those things we don't require. So it is not possible to read the IS code for other subjects and the IRC specifications. It is not possible to read all those things, right? Because we have to filter. We have to we have to understand what all things we have to study and what all things we shouldn't study. No need to study. That's it, right? So don't go behind all the concepts. What is required for gate examination, crisp and clear, that we are going to discuss. Okay, that only will help you. Otherwise, if you are studying all the things, you're going behind all the concepts, finally you will not be able to remember all those things. Okay, you have to recollect everything during the examination hall, right? You're going to study a lot of equations, lot of formula from all the chapters. So better study crisp and clear thing. That's why I recommend you to attend the classes regularly and study what all things is actually required. Okay, so in case if they are not giving the value of W, the width of the road, IRC is giving some value. And as per IRC, for a single lane road, you can write here, for a single lane road, the width of the road should be 3.75 meters. Okay, so this is in meter. This is in meter. This is what? This is the width of road or width of carriageway. Nothing but that W value. In case if they are not giving in the examination. Yeah, very good. So single lane road, 3.75 meter. For a two lane road, actually for a two lane road, there are two cases. Just remember that thing. For a two lane road, if a curb is there, okay, suppose there is no curb. So let it be no curb. Then it is 7 meter. Yeah, someone is replying. Very good, Uptal. 7 meter. But there is a twist. There may be some raised curb is there. What do you mean by this curb? Curb is nothing but, yeah, see, suppose you are having the road here. Here you are having some footpath. Okay, this is your footpath. This is your road. Here also you are having your footpath. So there is a separation in the elevation. Your road is here and then your footpath. So just to differentiate between the road and the footpath, we are giving some parameters, some element here between the road or the carriageway and the footpath. So this portion we are going to give some element which we are calling it as curb. Okay, curb. So suppose a curb is there, then we have to give some 0.5 meter extra. Yeah, very good. So if the curb is there, then 7.5 meter. Otherwise, if nothing is mentioned, it is 7 meter. By default, it is 7 meter. If they are giving, there is a raised curb in some element we are using. If they are giving that there is a curb, then 7.5 meter. Okay. And for multi lanes, what do you mean by multi lanes? If it is a 3 lane or 4 lane or 5 lane, 6 lane, anything, whatever be the number of lanes, multiplied by 3.5 meter. Okay. See, the default condition for lane is what? 7 meter. Nothing but 2 into 3.5. 7 meter. Okay. Yeah. Very good. So n into 3.5 we are taking in general, but only exceptional case is single lane. It is not 3.5. We are giving something extra, 3.75. And for 2 lane, if there is a raised curb, it will be 7.5 meter. So remember those things. Other things are n into 3.5 meter. Okay. See, this is a previous gate question for 1 mark, 3.75 meter. So they can ask you anything. And also these values we will be using in our other numerical concepts also, in horizontal curve and all. In the coming sessions, we'll be studying. There also we'll be using those concepts. Okay. So that's it. If they are not giving anything, by default, it is no curve, 7 meter. Otherwise, they have to give it. See, one more exceptional case is there. The term called intermediate lane. There is a term called intermediate lane, whereas the width is nothing but 5.5 meter. Okay, because of some site restrictions, we may not be able to give for a 2 lane drain the exact 7 meter. So in such cases, we are giving only 5.5 meter, at least 5.5 meter we should give. So just remember that term also, intermediate lane. So in case if they are asking what should be the minimum width intermediate lane, it should be 5.5 meter. Is camber is provided in CC payment? Yes, of course. In all the payments, we are going to give camber. But the thing is, for cement concrete payment means it's a superior road, right? Rigid payment, I can tell. Slight, some minute camber we will give compared to our other normal roads. We'll see that value. So good question. We'll see that. Okay, what are the values at all? So in case if they are not giving the value, we have to take as per IRC. See, these values have given as per, these are given by IRC, Indian Road Congress. So remember those values in case if they are not giving. And what is this N? Nothing but the slope, 1 in 20, 1 in 30, 1 in 40, like that they will give. So that second term of 1 in N, that the value of N. Okay, so I told you, sometimes they are not going to give you the value of W. Like that, if they are asking you a 2 marks question, they are not going to give you the N value also. Otherwise, there is substitution only, no? So they may not be giving the value of W and they may not be giving the value of N. Okay, both they will not give, but they will give some other parameters such as 2 lane, 3 lane, like that. So from that, we have to select what are the values of W and N. Okay, so I'm giving you how to calculate or how to take the value of N as per IRC and how to calculate that height of crown value. Okay. So I'm going to run this and I'm going to give you, in case if they are not giving the value of N, how to select that value. Okay. So there is a recommendation some set of recommended value as per our IRC. So we have to select the values of n from that particular table. Okay. So note down that table. Very, very important. They have already asked some one mark question from that. And also the same parameter we may be required in that numerical portions also. Okay. So the recommended value of camber as per IRC. Okay. So IRC recommendation for camber. So the one in n value depends on the type of the road and the rainfall. We have to select what is the value of camber. Okay. See why we are giving camber to drain off the rainwater. Right. So definitely if it is having very heavy rainfall, if it is the road is going to construct in a heavily rainfall area, then we have to give some more slope. Water has to remove, water has to drain off easily. If the portion, if the area is not that much rainfall area, if it is a less rainfall area, then we don't have to give more slope, right? Some minute slope will be sufficient, right? So according to the road, I can tell it as cement concrete road. Okay, you can tell it as this is a type of road. This is the type of road. And I'm going to give you the camber value also. Okay, so this is as per the camber 1 in n. So the type of road will be writing in the first column. Then the camber value for heavy rainfall area. For heavy rainfall area. And the next column will be for less rainfall area. For less rainfall area. So we don't have to check how we'll be determining whether it is a less rainfall area, whether it is a high rainfall area. We don't have to think about those things. It is already tabulated which all things, which all areas are coming under high rainfall area, which all portions are coming under less rainfall area. So they will be giving in the question as it is. We'll see the questions also, how they are going to ask. Okay. So, okay. The first one is the cement concrete road. I'm just writing it as CC. What is CC? Cement concrete, nothing but our rigid pavement. You might have studied, no? Flexible pavement, rigid pavement and all. Flexible pavement is nothing but bituminous, and rigid pavement is nothing but cement concrete. Okay. So cement concrete road is their first one. And cement concrete as well as some high type. Suppose some high type bituminous pavement may be there. High type bituminous. Cement concrete road or high type bituminous pavement. If it is of this category, then the 1 in value will be 1 in 60. And this will be 1 in 50. So we are writing. So if it is a low type bituminous pavement, no need to confuse what is this high type and low type and all. They will give as it is. That much in detail we don't require actually. Okay. So this will be 1 in 40. This will be 1 in 50. You have to by heart these values. WBM road. What do you mean by WBM road? Waterbound macadam. You might have studied. You might have heard that word already, right? Waterbound macadam. How to construct waterbound macadam and all, we don't require for our exam. Okay. So study the things crisp and clear. What all things are actually needed. This is 1 in 33. This will be 1 in 40. Then we are having earth road. We are having earth road. So if they are asking the questions, they will exactly give the same wordings. If it is earth road, this will be 1 in 25 and 1 in 33. So you have to remember these values. You have to by heart these values because they have already asked the values directly. This value they have already asked. What will be the camber? What is the recommended value of camber as per IRC for a cement concrete road for less rainfall area? So like that they have already asked the question. So anything, any value from this table they can ask you. Okay, so if you have completed writing, please let me know. I will give you the numericals how they are going to ask. If you have completed, please let me know. better write fast so that we can complete so many questions. We can practice so many questions. How many questions we can solve, that many we should do. Then only we'll remember the formula and all. Only practice makes you perfect, especially for gate examination. See, for gate examination, you don't have to work hard, but you have to work smartly. That's it. Whatever we are studying, crisp and clear things you should remember. So solve so many questions and remember the formula. Gate is not for hard workers. It is for smart workers. So remember the things. No need to go too deep and understand what are these types of road, how it is constructed. Those things we don't require. If you need that, yes, well and good. You can go through that, but after the gate exam. Okay, don't waste your time. Fine. See, I told you this question has already asked. I will give you that theory concept also. Okay, see, directly, I told you it is 1 in N. Means what is that N? What is that N? N means it can be 60, it can be 50, it can be 40, it can be 33, it can be 25 and all. Is there any trick to remember it? Yeah, okay. See, you can make your own tricks to remember. That's a good thing, to make some tricks to remember. Okay, I will tell you something. See, just remember this thing only, 60. So it will be minus 10. Then take directly here. Again, it is minus 10. Take directly here. But here, if you are minusing 10, then you are going to get 30. Right? This is my trick. You can you can accept that trick or you can make your own tricks, no problem. See, till here it is okay, minus 10, minus 10. So if it is minus 10, you should get some 30, right? So since it is 30, I know there is some change here, right? So I'm just going to add the first letter, 3. So it will be 33, something like that, you remember. So directly it is coming here, 1 in 33. So if it is 33, our trick is what? Minus 10. If it is 33, it should be 23, right? So it should be 23. So since it is 23, I'm adding the first one. So it will become 25. So that is 25. So at least you can remember like that. Or in terms of percentage also, you can remember. Yeah, very good. In terms of percentage also, you can remember. But the thing is, it will be better if you're studying in this format. Because that W by 2N, if you're studying in percentage, again, you have to convert into this form. Okay. So 60, 50, 50, 40, 40, 33, 33, 25. Fine. So this thing will be always whatever here, it will be in the next column. What will be here? Next column. Whatever will be here in the next column. Okay. Like this, we can remember. Definitely. Definitely, you can remember. Make some tricks and remember. And see, not only that, the parameters also you should remember. First, who will be coming first? Who is having more mark, right? So exactly, first column will be heavy rainfall. Second column will be less rainfall. And also see, this is nothing but we are arranging in the order of quality of the payment. CC payment means cement concrete payment will be having highest quality. So the quality, if you are checking, here it is having highest quality. Quality is increasing, right? So whenever the quality is decreasing, camber is also decreasing. Okay, sorry, camber is increasing. It is 1 in 25, no? So what do you mean by 1 in 60? Nothing but 1 by 60. Whenever you are going 60 horizontal, you are having 1 vertical. It is something like this. What do you mean by 1 in 33 or 1 in 25? Whenever you are going 25, here itself you are having 1. Means that is 1 by 25. So 1 by 25 is more compared to 1 by 60. So as the quality is decreasing, camber is increasing. That point also you remember. You can write it as a note after this. So as the quality is decreasing, camber will be increasing. It is reciprocal, right? It is having highest quality. So 1 in N, nothing but 1 by 60 is less value. So you can write that point. As the quality of payment increases, the camber is going to decrease. Yeah, that's why someone has asked, no, whether in cement concrete payment we are going to give camber or not. Yes, we are going to give, but it is having highest quality, so the camber will be very less. That's what I told, very less camber. What is the recommended value? 1 in 60. See, suppose in the question they are giving some other value, then we have to take as it is. In case if they are not giving, then only we'll go through this table given by IRC. Okay. So I'm giving you a numerical question rather than just by hearting all the formula or the parameters. Just apply in the questions and see how to use in our GATE exam. Okay. So just take down a question. I'm just going to give a question. You can just take down. Write it. A two-lane cement concrete road. We can use the short wordings and all again, right? A two-lane cement concrete road is to be constructed at a place of heavy rainfall. A two-lane road, CC pavement, it is going to construct at some heavy rainfall area. Next sentence. What should be the height of crown with respect to the edge of the pavement? Yeah, same thing. What is the height of the crown with respect to edge of the pavement? Maybe that's why they are going to ask. That's how they are going to ask. Height of the crown means what? With respect to the edge of the pavement. Yes, calculate. What will be W? See, they have not given the value of W, not given the value of M. If it is a two-lane road, by default, for a two-lane road, W is 7 meter, right? If it has given that there is a raised camber, then we have to take 7.5. N value. So we know the equation is W by 2N. So W we already know, 7 meter. N means what? In the 1 in N, what is that N value? It's a cement concrete road, which means the first one. And it is having heavy rainfall area, which means camber is 1 in 50. Camber means what? 1 in N. 1 in N is 1 in 50. Then what is your N value? Your N value is nothing but 50. So substitute. How much you are getting? Tell me. Very good, Abdal. Yes, Abhishek. Correct only. For the proper drainage, it is necessary to do that. And if some erosion, if it is going to affect the road, we'll be taking this other preventive measures also. So give me the answer, others, please. What will be the value? So that I'll be understanding whether you are getting the concept or not. So the unit also you have to take care. So this is 7 meter divided by 2 into 50. See, in whatever unit, yeah, very good. Very good, very good. Others also giving. Yeah, very good, Varun, Abhishek, good. So whatever unit you are going to substitute the width of the road, in same unit you are going to get it. Because these two are having no unit. No? So this will be 0.07 meter. Suppose the question is, what is the height of crown in centimeter? So in transportation, this is the one of the important thing. Unit you have to take care like anything. They can ask you a variety of questions, but the thing is in bracket, they will put the unit also. So in case, if it is a numerical answer type question, you're not getting the options. So you will not be realizing that you're entering some wrong answers. So especially for numerical answer type, always take care of the units. Yeah, very good. Very good, Manjunath. Very good, John. Debashish, good. So 0.7 meter, nothing but 7 centimeter. Okay, so in whatever unit they are asking, accordingly you substitute. Here I have not given the units. Okay, whatever it is. So 0.7 meter. Understanding how we are going to substitute. Suppose the same question. I'm just giving you another question from the same question. Instead of heavy rainfall, let the same data do it for less rainfall area. Suppose the area is a less rainfall area. Do the same and check what value you're going to get. Yeah, very good. In all the subjects, units are very important. Okay, but generally they used to make twist in transportation. Yes, as Abhishek is telling, for hydrology irrigation also, they used to make twist in the units. Okay, and whatever be the subject, always take care of the units. 7 by 120. Yeah, very good. So 0.05. Just tell me in centimeters. Just tell me in centimeters. So YC will be W by 2. So 7 meters divided by 2 into, it will be 60 instead of 50. So 0.0583 something, I guess. So 5.83 centimeter. Getting? Very good, 5.8. See, one more thing I'm telling you. Generally for gate examination, apart from the unit, they will be giving in bracket, round off to one integer place, round off to two decimal places, round off to one decimal places, like that. Okay. So always take the values very accurately, and whatever they are going to give you. Suppose in this question, they are giving round off to one decimal, which means it is 5.8. Okay. Suppose you are getting some 6.97. You can either write it as 5.9 or 6.0. The range may be something like that. So proper range they are going to give. Okay. So in this question, 5.83, in case the question was round off to one decimal, which means after the decimal point, there should be one. Okay. They will give a range. So 5.8 like that. Okay. So always check. Sometimes they will give round off to the nearest integer. Take care of those things. Okay. If it is round off to the nearest integer, which means it is six. So maybe in the range, they are going to give some 5 to 6 or something. Okay. Depends. Okay. May not be for this question. I'm telling in general. Okay. Always check in which unit they are asking the question and up to what decimal we have to write the, we have to enter the answer. That is particularly for numerical answer type where the options are not available. If it is a multiple choice question in which you are having the options, then no need to take care of those things, but unit, you have to check it. Sometimes they will give the values in meters as well as in centimeters in the options. So always check in which unit they are going to ask the question. Okay. So understood how to calculate the height of crown. Sometimes they may be giving you the value directly. See, one more thing. Here we have taken 7 meter, right? Why we have taken 7 meter? Because in the question, W is not given. That's why. Suppose in the question, W is given, then we have to take as it is, whatever the value given. Whenever we are not having a particular data, then who is going to help us? IRC is going to help us to take some standard values. Suppose in the same question, they are giving the camber. See, instead of this 1 in 15, they're telling that the camber is 1 in 55. Then you have to substitute 55 only. Whatever they are giving, take as it is. Sometimes they will give some other subjects. See, acceleration due to gravity. If they are not giving, we'll take 9.81. Suppose they are giving the value as 10, then you have to take it as 10, right? And also we have studied the coefficient of friction 0.35 to 0.4 and lateral friction 0.15. That is the standard values for design. In case in the question, if they're giving some other value, we have to take the given value. Okay. Yeah, that's what Sohan, the difference between a WBM. See, we are having so many roads, waterbound macadam road, wet mix macadam road. So many things are there, not required for gate examination. Okay. For bituminous pavement, we are using so many param in like coarse aggregate, we'll be using fine aggregate. We're having so many mixes and all. So in detail, we don't require for this particular concept. When we are going into the pavement materials, pavement design, still, if you want to know that, definitely we'll be discussing there. Okay. So, but always check what all things are actually required. Here, we don't require those things. Also for gate examination, we don't require what are the construction methods for these things. If you really wanted to know, I will give you my mail ID and all. You can ask me. I will give you the reply. Don't worry. Or whenever we are doing the pavement design sessions and all, we can discuss there. No problem. Okay. So I hope you understood how to calculate the camber and all. So that is one of the important parameters while considering the cross-sectional elements. And we are having some other cross-sectional elements also, such as median and all. Not that much important for gate examination. Now I'm going into the sight distance. Okay. One of the important thing I will, but before that, I will just list out what are the other cross-sectional elements. Not that much important. Whatever we have discussed will be sufficient, will be more than sufficient to get a 1 mark or 2 marks from the cross-sectional element portion. Okay, so there are some other parameters also, such as the next one, you can write it as median. What do you mean by median? Just tell me what is meant by median. Everything is very much related to our day-to-day life, right? What do you mean by median? Why to use median? What is the purpose of using a median? Road separator, very good. I will be giving you the exact thing. See, suppose there are two roads or there are two lanes. Both are going in this direction. Whether we'll be using a median here, what do you mean by median? Yes, road separator is actually correct, which means we are going to construct something here, right? So if both are of the same line, same direction, will we use a median? No, we are not going to use a median. Whenever we are having two different directions, yeah, very good, Manju. If you are having two different directions, suppose these two are two lane roads. So in this road, it is going in this direction. Here it is coming in this direction. Then we are going to use a median. Or if it is a four lane road, generally for a four lane road, how the directions will be? Here it will be having in the consecutive two lanes, it will be having same direction. And on the third line, it will be having this direction. Fourth line, it will be having this direction. So generally, this is what a four lane road is, right? So for a four lane road, we'll be having a median here. Just to avoid that head-on collisions, that's why we are using median. So what is actually median? We are separating the traffic directions actually. Okay, we are separating the traffic direction. So that's what I told. We know it is used for separating the road, but it's not actually the road. We are just separating the traffic directions. Okay, yeah, good. So we are using it to separate the roads. Very good, it is also correct, but technically more precisely it is for traffic directions. Okay, and that is median. Then curb, we have already seen what is the curb. Width of the road, we have already seen that also. Then I can tell you, yeah, shoulder is there, shoulder. What do you mean by shoulder? It's nothing but something like this. On both sides, we are having shoulders. We are having the head here, we are having the shoulder here, exactly like that. Suppose this is the carriageway. What do you mean by a carriageway? Nothing but where the vehicle is moving, our road only, okay? Carriageway. And after this road, we will be having some portions here, right? Some portions. Why we are using that portions? Just for temporary parking. Suppose you got a call while driving, what you'll do? Most probably you may be slowing down the vehicle and keep on moving while talking. Don't do that. You have to park in on the side of the road, then you have to attend the call. After the call, then you can proceed. That's what we have to do to live long, right? So for that temporary parking and all, what we require? We require some space here on both sides of the road. If you are moving in this direction, you have to park here. If someone is coming from the other direction, he has to park here. So this portion, we call it as shoulder. Okay, very good. So it is called as shoulder. So this is carriageway. This portion is carriageway. And this blue portion is called as shoulder. There is actually a minimum width of this carriageway. There should be 2.5 meter. Those things you can remember. See why it is 2.5. As per Indian road, see this value is as per IRC, Indian Road Congress. So practically it may not be exactly 2.5. Sometimes it may be more than that. Sometimes it may be less than that. If it is less than 2.5, it is going to affect our traffic. Okay. See why it is 2.5. I'm just giving you for your better knowledge. So this is our carriageway. There should be some 2.5. Now, as per IRC, the maximum width of a vehicle should be, suppose this is the backside of a vehicle, this maximum width can be 2.44 meter only. Note down those things for your better knowledge, and for other competitive exams also, these things may help you. See, a lot of exams are there, na? So yes, gate exam is there, RRB exam is there, SSC exam is there, ISRO exam may be there. Not only that, if you're getting some good score, you may be getting called for the PSUs. For PSUs also, they will be asking some questions. Interviews will be there. So during the interviews, they may be asking such things. Okay. So 2.44 meter is the maximum width of a vehicle as per IRC. So a vehicle has to park here. So that maybe the maximum width is 2.44 meter. So at least we should need something more than this, then only we can park it, right? So if it is a 2.5 meter, then we can easily park our 2.44 meter width vehicle. That is a maximum value. Suppose we are not having that much. We are giving some 2 meter only, let it be. We are giving only 2 meter. What is the problem? Suppose some big vehicle has cave, some truck or something having very wide, maximum value will be 2.44. So suppose I'm giving 2 only. What is the problem? It will be parking something like this. See, this thing definitely you might have experienced in your day-to-day life. The shoulder is still here only, but the vehicle width is more than the shoulder width, so that the vehicle will be using some part of your road. So while you're driving, you can see some parked vehicle may be there. So you have to slow down and you have to take the deviation and go. The parked vehicles are going to affect your movement, which are going on the road. That's why IRC is telling some minimum 2.5 meter is required. Practically may not be possible because in India, everything is congested, right? We are not having that much land space. Yes, we are having huge land, but the thing is almost all the land is occupied. We are not having vacant land, right? So near to the road, we'll be having all the shops on the footpath itself. Some shops may be there. So we are not having much space. So because of the site constraints, practically it may not be able to provide 2.5. That's why we are seeing some parked vehicles. The right wheel of the vehicle will be on the road. Left wheel will be on the shoulder like that. Okay. So that's why IRC is recommending some minimum value of 2.5 meters. So remember that it may help you. These values, everything may help you. Not only in gate exam, but also for other interviews, other competitive exams also. Okay, so that is shoulder. So remember those cross-sectional elements. So you can expect a 1 mark question from here. Many times they have asked you, asked the questions. So yeah, let me simply read some gate questions, theory questions, okay? The value of lateral friction is how much? Tell me, reply fast. What is the value of lateral friction? Coefficient of lateral friction. Very good, Abhishek. Very good, Varun. 0.15, right? See, 2 times gate question. Okay. Easy to score. Let it be there. Next question. A camber is provided to take care of drainage, stopping side distance, off tracking, centrifugal force. You have already given me the reply, right? So why we are giving the drain? Why you are giving the camber? For drainage purpose, right? So another 1 mark question that is also asked for gate exam. What is the width of a single lane carriageway? Yeah, very good, drainage. You have already replied while I was taking the class. That's why I didn't ask you again. What is the width of a single lane carriageway? 3.75, very good. This is a single lane. This has already asked for 1 mark, okay? So always remember the twist. What are the twist? For 2 lane, if it is a raised curve, then it is not 7, it is 7.5. And for N term, is there intermediate? For intermediate carriageway, 5.5. In all other parameters, whatever be the number of lanes into 3.5. Okay, very good. So remember those things. That's it. See that value of camber for CC pavement for heavy rainfall area. That is also a previous gate question. See how simply they are going to give you the marks. What is the camber value for cement concrete for heavy rainfall area? They have given the options 1 by 50, 1 by 40, 1 by 30, 1 by 25. What is the value for cement concrete area? Cement concrete, yes, very good. 1 by 50. That's why I told you better study in one in n term rather than by hearting in percentage. You can by heart this 1 by 50, like 2.5%, 2%. Like that, you can remember 1.8%. Okay, 1.25 is there instead of like that. You can study that 1/4, I mean, like that. Okay, so this much percentage enrolled. But again, if they are asking such questions, you have to convert like this. If you're studying like this, it's very easy to convert into percentage, right? 1/50, nothing but 0.02, 2%. That's it. Okay, and also if they are asking in that camber, so far they have not asked that, but anytime they can ask you a question there, because they have already asked the question for W, they have already asked the value for camber. Then if they are combining it, they have asked for 1 mark, 1 mark. If they are combining it, they can ask you a 2 marks question that we have already discussed. Okay, what is the difference between median and divider? See, divider is nothing but something we are using for dividing. That's it. Okay, in general term, median and divider is same. Divider we can use for anything. Okay, whatever thing you are using for, some deviating the traffic, controlling the traffic, nothing but the divider. General sense, divider and median are the same. Technically speaking, it is median. Okay, so that are the cross-sectional elements. Now we are going to see one of the very, very, very important concepts for GATE examination, nothing but the sight distance. Okay, so I told you we are having 2-3 types of sight distance. First one is the stopping sight distance. That is the most important sight distance. Then comes to the overtaking sight distance. Then a small concept is there called as intermediate sight distance. Okay, the numerical portion is there only for stopping sight distance and the overtaking sight distance. And intermediate sight distance is easy. There is no calculations and all, one simple theory concept. Okay, so what you mean by sight distance? Nothing but, no need to study anything extra, whatever we are doing in our day-to-day life. You're riding your vehicle. I hope everyone will be riding the vehicle. Either it can be a car, either it can be a bike, whatever it is. Or you might have already, no need to tell, right? Everyone is a road user. Whenever you are riding your vehicle, yes, very good, Abhishek. The distance you should see in front of you, the clear distance in front of you is called as sight distance. Okay, why don't listen? Lag distance, brake distance is what? Stopping sight distance. Actually, we are having different types of sight distance. Sometimes they can ask you, see, so for this stopping sight distance, they have already asked you a 1 mark question from the definition of this stopping sight distance. That's what I'm telling. Sight distance in the general sense means whatever the clear distance in front of you. That's it. If you want to stop the vehicle, that is called stopping sight distance. If you want to overtake, it is called as overtaking sight distance. Okay, so we are going to see our first one, the stopping sight distance. So it's a easy concept actually. So you might have already studied in the colleges. I can tell it as, see, in actual word is the safe stopping sight distance. Okay, but we denote it as SSD only. It is the safe stopping sight distance. So what it is, no need to elaborate a lot. You might have already studied these things. We'll concentrate on numerical problems. Okay, that will be better for you while you're writing the exams. So what is that? Everyone knows, suppose your vehicle, you're riding your vehicle. So again, our car is there, our previous car we have drawn. So suppose that let it be some 60 km/h, you're riding your vehicle. Okay, so you're riding your vehicle at 60 km/h, you're seeing something here. What is that something? It is nothing but an obstruction which can affect you, which can make an accident. See, whatever you're seeing, will you apply the brake? No. Suppose this paper is there on the road, will you apply your brake? Definitely not. Why? Why you're not applying the brake if this paper is there on the road? Because you know that this paper is not going to affect you. How you know that? Because your brain is having the knowledge that this paper is not going to affect you. See, some small babies, they may touch fire and all, no? Why? Because they don't know it is going to burn. Their brain don't know. Once they experience that, their brain knows that, okay, next time if I'm touching, it is going to affect me. So your brain already knows that which all particles are going to affect you and which all things are not going to affect you. IRC says that if the height of this object, if it is more than 0.15 meter, or I can tell it as 15 centimeter, then it is going to affect you. See, the height will not be that much compared to this car. I was simply drawing. Something is here, okay? So if the height of the object is more than 15 centimeter, how to remember that value? Height of a scale, that small scale, 15 centimeter. Now you'll not forget that, okay? So if it is more than that, then only that object is going to affect you, right? See, on the roads, generally you can see the light reflectors, right? Some reflectors may be there. They are using for line separation and all. Okay, see, that also a divider, right? But it is not a median. Something which we are using to divide is called as divider. Some right reflectors may be there, having some 2 centimeter, 3 centimeters height. That is not going to affect you. Used to ride the vehicle on that, which is having less than that 15 centimeter. Okay, suppose you're having a 15 centimeter object or more than that. So your brain already knows that it is going to affect you. Bro, you are going to meet an accident. So what you have to do? The brain will tell you, apply the brake, right? So you're seeing the obstruction there. Let's see what all things actually happening. You're seeing the object. At the moment you're seeing the object, your brain will take some few seconds to realize that what it is. See, suddenly you're seeing something. You may take some 1 or 2 seconds to realize that, okay, it's a paper. If it is a paper, it is not going to affect me. I don't have to stop. You have to make a decision, no? Suppose that is that can be a breakdown vehicle, right? A breakdown vehicle is there sometimes. So if it is a breakdown vehicle, your brain will make a decision. Okay, that is a breakdown vehicle. If this guy is going at the same speed of 60, definitely he's going to hit that car and he is going to meet with an accident. So I have to tell this guy to stop the vehicle. The brain will tell you, stop the vehicle. Then you are going to apply the brake. For that decision making by the brain, your brain will be taking a few seconds. Very good, Abhishek, as per PIEV theory. So your brain is taking some few seconds. In that few seconds, your vehicle is moving at the constant speed. So suppose you have reached somewhere here, the same vehicle. Okay. So here also your speed is 60 kmph only. Right, because in that time your brain is taking some time. To make the decision whether you have to stop your vehicle or no need to stop. You can continue. Your brain is taking some time, right? So at this moment, your brain has already made the decision. What you are going to do now? Here we are going to apply the brakes. Right? Here we are applying the brakes. Finally, we are going to stop somewhere here, so that our vehicle is safe. So we have stopped here. Now our vehicle is stopped against some collision with the object. So this distance from this location to this location, I can call it as safe stopping sight distance. We denoted it as SSD only, stopping sight distance, but the actual word is safe stopping sight distance. So I can divide into two parts. See, I hope you know that PIEV theory. Okay, I'm not elaborating that PIEV theory. As per IRC, PIEV theory, P stands for some perception. Nothing but whenever you're seeing something, the signal will be passed to your brain. Nothing but perception, intellection. What do you mean by intellection? It is nothing but, I told you, the baby doesn't know that if it is touching the fire, it will get burned. Why? Because he is not having any previous experience. His brain don't know that. Intellection means from the previous data, from the previous knowledge, whatever you have gained in this 20, 22 years, your brain is going to correlate with the previous experience. If you're seeing something there, okay, it is going to affect you. It is going to make some decision. Nothing but intellection. The comparison of things. Emotion. What do you mean by emotion? It is not that emotion. It's like you may get feared. If you're a fresh driver, you may be getting shivered and all, right? If you're an experienced driver, you may be easy with that. You may be experienced a lot of things with that, right? So that is nothing but the emotion. Maybe you're riding your vehicle having some tension. yes, definitely, you may be taking some time to apply the brake, going to affect your time for reaction making. V is nothing but the volition, nothing but finally, after making the decision, the brain will tell you, beta, apply the brake. So you have to apply the brake. That is nothing but PIEV theory. Okay. So for all these things, we need some time. That time is called as reaction time. Very, very important. Generally, we represent using small letter T. So what is actually happening in this first part? From here to here, the vehicle is moving during the reaction time. So in that reaction time, actually, we are not applying the brake, right? We are simply lagging. Our brain is taking some time to make the decision. We're simply lagging. So that distance is called as lag distance. Someone have already replied. Very good. And here only we are going to apply the brake. So from here, we are going to decrease the speed. Finally, speed will be zero. This distance after applying the brake, we are calling it as braking distance. Or sometimes you can see a brake distance and all, more or less the same. So braking distance and brake distance, everything is same. Okay. So lag distance and brake distance. If you're adding this lag distance plus brake distance, what you're going to get? Safe stopping sight distance or SSD, simply both are same. Okay. So now we have to see how to calculate this lag distance and how to calculate this braking distance. Very important thing. Okay. So lag distance is nothing but whatever be the speed here. See, don't simply by heart the equation. I will tell you how it is coming and all. So lag distance is nothing but speed in meter per second into the reaction time T. So I hope you are parallelly noting down. So speed into reaction time T. You might have already studied some value for this reaction time. I will tell you how, when you have to use that. So V into T, the braking distance is nothing but V square divided by 2GF. See, this is the general case. There are some special cases also. I'll be giving you there. So here also V is in meter per second. G is the acceleration due to gravity. F is nothing but we are having two frictions, right? Coefficient of longitudinal we are having. Coefficient of side friction also we are having. So here we are going to use coefficient of longitudinal friction. Why? Because our vehicle is moving in the straight road. Okay. Coefficient of friction. Yeah, that's what we have discussed now. Very good doubt. So we have to take coefficient of longitudinal friction because we are going in the straight road, right? Whenever we are studying about the horizontal curves, in the coming sessions, we'll be discussing those things. Whenever we are discussing about horizontal curves, that we are turning. So when you're having a tendency to go sidewise, so someone is helping you to resist that skidding, then we will take that 0.15. Okay. This is also in meter per second. This is also in meter per second. Why we have to take meter per second? No need to by heart these things. See, this reaction time, how much time your brain will take? Will it take some minutes or hours? If it is taking some hours, definitely you're going to hit and no need to calculate the stopping sight distance, right? Definitely it may be some few seconds. Since it is seconds, you need to get some value in meters. Then this should be in meter per second. Meter per second, this second and second will cancel. Then you'll get meters, right? Here, what is G? Acceleration due to gravity. 9.81 meter per second square. Okay. So this is also will be in meter per second. This is not having any unit. It's an empirical formula. Okay. So that should be in meter per second. This also should be in meter per second. So we'll get some value in meters. We'll get some values in meters. Then adding those two things, we'll get the safe stopping sight distance. See, this formula you might have already studied in the classes, right? In college. But I'm going to tell you how these equations are actually coming. Yes, I know for the gate examination, the derivations are not needed. But I'm just giving you the derivation for this particular concept only. Why? Because since it is a very easy concept, see, direct calculation, right? It's like an 8th standard question. You can't expect simple questions every time. Sometimes they can make some test. So if they are making some test, then you have to identify how to make some changes. Yes, if they are giving some gradient and all, there will be a change. I will give you that. Before that, I'm going to give some derivations. See, lag distance. We know in physics, we have studied distance is nothing but, what is the equation for distance? Vt plus half at square. If an object is moving at an acceleration of a, who is having the initial speed v for a distance t seconds, it is ut or vt plus half at square. We have already studied that. But see, here, whether it is having any acceleration or deceleration, no. In that reaction time, you are constantly moving. What is the example we have taken? Example we have taken 60. So you are constantly moving at 60, and in that some 2 seconds or 3 seconds, your brain is going to make a decision. Okay. So in this portion, in this lag distance, the acceleration is how much? Zero. Why? Because you are moving at constant speed. So if you are going at constant speed, acceleration is zero. So this part is going to be zero. That's why it is coming as V into T. Understand, there they will not be making any twist. Definitely the acceleration will be zero. Okay. Now, coming to the braking distance. If in clearance, we are taking curve, but sorry, I will come to that later. One second. So the braking distance, how we are actually getting this equation? You might have already studied in plus two physics and all. The change in kinetic energy. The change in kinetic energy is what? The work done. So what is the work here? Stopping the vehicle. We are applying the brake. So finally, it is going to stop. Who is helping you to stop the vehicle? Who is helping you to stop the vehicle? You have already replied before when we were discussing the cross-section elements. This work is done by the frictional force. Right? This frictional force is going to do the work. Right. Very good, Abhishek. So what is the change in kinetic energy? The final kinetic energy minus initial kinetic energy. So kinetic energy equation. What is the kinetic energy equation? Nothing but half mv2 square minus half mv1 square. The final kinetic energy minus initial kinetic energy. We know the final speed is how much? Zero. One second. Yeah, sorry for the interruption. So half mv2 square minus half mv1 square is equal to work done, right? So in this case, we know the final speed is how much? Zero. So this part is going to become zero. So you please note down these things. This is actually required. I will tell you how. Okay. So this part is going to become zero. So remaining part is half mv1 square. So who is doing the work? Who is doing the work? The friction. What will be the work done by a force? Force into distance. What is our distance? Braking distance. Now, what will be the force? Force into distance. So distance is nothing but the braking distance. I told you, what is the frictional force? Coefficient of friction into the normal reaction. So coefficient of friction into what will be the normal reaction? Whenever an object is there, it will be having a normal reaction R. Maybe you might have already studied in engineering mechanics, or you might have definitely studied in plus two physics and all. There will be an upward support reaction, normal reaction. It will be equal to the weight of the object W, right? So W is nothing but mass into G, mg, nothing but weight. So the normal reaction, F into the normal reaction, where I'm writing this normal reaction is nothing but our weight. Weight is what? Mg, right? Into the braking distance. Till here, it is clear. What I require? I require the braking distance only. Now, what will be the braking distance? This half mv square divided by f into mg. Right? See, the vehicle is moving in that direction and the friction is in the opposite direction. Right? So it is actually minus. It's a minus friction, right? It is in the opposite direction. Here we are having a minus. Here also we are having a minus. So that minus minus will get cancelled. Finally, this m and m will cancel. Finally, what you're getting? V square by 2gf. That's how this equation is coming. Now see, now you may be wondering why I have given these derivations and all. We require only the final formula. Yes, you require only the final formula. But the thing is, sometimes they can make a twist in this question. Suppose they are giving you that at some instant, the vehicle is having a speed of some 30 kmph. See here, we know the speed is going to decrease, and finally becoming here. Suppose they are giving that in some instant, the vehicle is having some speed of 30 km/h. Then what may be the distance traveled by this car or vehicle from this point of applying the brake till that point? What is this distance? If they are asking such a question, what you will do? If you are using V square by 2GF, you are not going to get the correct answer. If you are using V square by 2GF, what you are going to get? The complete braking distance. In case if they are giving some intermediate point and giving you the speed, I told you, they can ask the questions like anything. So this is somewhat some level 3 or level 4 type of question. In case if they are giving some values like that, what you have to do? Then you have to apply this concept. See, final speed was zero. That's why we got only half mv square. Suppose if they're giving some concept there like that, then what you have to do? This final speed, not it will be equal to zero. It will be half into m into. See, we have to convert that into meter per second. So correspondingly, this v will be 30 kmph square, half mv square minus half into m into, that's 60 kmph square. See, we have to convert into meter per second while calculating. I will give you a question how to calculate and all. Finally, the equation will become, in case if they are giving some value like that, our final, this equation will become some v2 square minus v1 square divided by 2gf. Okay, so whatever, you can write v1 or v2, anything, depends on the values. So in case if they are giving some 30 km, what will be that distance and all, then use both the values, then divided by v square by 2gf. See, here I can take this half m common, no? Then I can write v1 square minus v2 square. So nothing but, instead of simply v square, we'll be getting two terms. Okay, so remember those things in case if they are making some twist to ask you a two mass question. See, in case whatever question they are going to ask from this numerical, definitely it will be for 2 marks. Okay, easily you're going to get. But even if they are making some twist, don't lose your mark. By thinking that, array, this is stopping side distance, very easy, we'll be easily getting the marks. Don't take it as silly. Since it is easy, it is more dangerous. They can twist the question also. So whatever they are asking, easily you can solve. Okay, so this is a level road condition. Okay, so sometimes, yes, someone have already mentioned, they can ask you what is the stopping side distance on an inclined road. If they are giving some inclined road, which means it is having some gradient, that slope, that longitudinal slope, we are calling it as some gradient, right? So I hope you have already noted down these things. I'm going to rub this just to write our next case. So this is what we have discussed is a level road. Now suppose instead of this level road, they are giving some gradient. Okay, so it can be an upward gradient, that is your vehicle is going something like this, or it can be a downward gradient, which means suppose on the same gradient your vehicle is coming in this opposite direction. Sorry, so your vehicle is coming in this opposite direction, then what will be the stopping side distance? See, will you think if a gradient is there, whether it will change or not? Just tell me, if it is an upward gradient, this is upward gradient, this is downward gradient or decreasing gradient. If it is an upward gradient, see, from your experience, tell me, if you are going up, whether you need more distance to stop or less distance to stop. Just tell me from your experience, if you are going up, what will be, if you are going up, you need, very good, you need less only, right? Because there will be a component of your weight of the vehicle which is trying to pull your vehicle backside. So that much distance you don't require because you're getting some extra pull backside, right? So while going upward, you need some less stopping side distance. So here actually, stopping side distance is going to decrease compared to our level. So this is nothing but a level road, right? So compared to this first case, in this case, SSD is going to decrease. What about downward gradient? You're coming like something like this. Then you need more or less or equal. If you're going downward, what it will be? Definitely you might have experienced in your day-to-day life, right? If you're going downward, the SSD will be, yeah, SSD is going to increase, right? Very good. Very good. Of course, it is more. Because your weight is in the downward direction now, a component of weight, it is going to pull you downward. So there is a change in the stopping side distance formula if they are giving some gradient. I'm just denoting it as some n percentage. I told you either I can represent in 1 in n or I can represent, I've already used that same letter, small letter n. So I'm just giving some. See, there is one more notation, plus n percentage minus n percentage. Sometimes if they are giving some plus value, which means it's an increasing gradient or upward gradient, or if they are giving some minus 3%, minus 2%, which means it is a downward. Okay, so see that notations also, sometimes they can give like this instead of telling you whether it is an upward or downward. Okay, so what is the change is going to happen? This is going to affect our braking distance only, not the lag distance. So write a note, the lag distance will not change. Lag distance is V into T itself. Now what will be the braking distance? It is equal to V square divided by 2G F plus or minus N percentage by 100. Why I'm writing plus or minus? If it is an upward gradient, we know it is plus. And if it is a downward gradient, it will be minus. Okay, we'll do some questions also how to calculate that. See, why I have written that it is n percentage by 100 and all. Why I have written that n percentage by 100 and all? Because we have to substitute the values in terms of decimals. Means, suppose this is given as an example. They have given some minus 4%, or let it be some minus 2%, which means while substituting, see what will be the F value. Suppose let it be some 0.35 minus 0.02. Like that, we have to substitute the decimal value, like whatever be the percent, divide by 100. Okay, so this is the next case. This is level road. This is an inclined road. One more twist they can give. Instead of simply giving these are the values, that are the values. See, I hope you have written this point also, V1 square minus V2 square. Suppose if they are giving you a term called as braking efficiency, you can write it as a note. If they are giving some braking efficiency, see what you mean by this braking efficiency? I'm just denoting with a letter E. Okay, any letter you can give, any notation. What do you mean by this braking efficiency? If your brakes are 100% efficient, which means if you're applying the brake, your vehicle will stop within a distance of V square by 2GF. It doesn't mean that braking efficiency is 100%. Doesn't mean that whenever you're stopping, whenever you're applying the brake, your vehicle will stop. It's not the case. 100% braking efficiency means if you're applying the brake, after a distance of V square by 2GF, your vehicle is going to stop. Or if it is a gradient, after a distance of V square by 2G into F plus or minus N by 100, your vehicle is going to stop. Okay, so exact same value you will get if the 100% efficiency is there. See, Definitely, if you are using your vehicle, if the brakes are worn out, after some period of time, what happens? Even if you are applying the brake, your vehicle may be simply going on, right? You might have used the cycles, no, in childhood. So if you're applying the brake, still your cycle may be moving. Why it is happening? Because of the brakes, that thing has already gone, which means the braking efficiency is less. If it was efficient, then within some shorter distance, it may be stopping. Now the braking efficiency is going to decrease. Yeah, very good, Abhishek. So if they're giving you some braking efficiency E, the lag distance is same, the brake distance is going to change. What will be that braking distance? V square divided by 2G into EF, the frictional value. If the braking efficiency is 100%, you will get the complete friction. If the braking efficiency is less, that friction that you're going to get is less, right? So it is E into F. In general sense, I'm writing plus or minus N by 100. If it is a level road, N is zero. So it will be simply E into F only. Now, what will be the lag distance? Lag distance is same VT. So if you're adding this, I will be getting my stopping sight distance. Okay, which means suppose the coefficient of friction, this is not capital F, this is small f, coefficient of friction. Capital G generally denote for frictional force. Okay, see what it actually means. Suppose 100% efficiency, the small f value is some 0.4. Then if it is 50% efficiency, finally it will be, efficiency is 50% means 0.5. So 0.5 we have to multiply with the coefficient of friction. Okay, so I hope you understood those concepts of stopping sight distance. So let's do some questions for the better understanding. Okay, so which all points you should remember? Here you have to substitute in terms of decimal, 1 point. Second point, you should substitute the value of speed in meter per second. And the third point, if they are giving some efficiency, you have to multiply the efficiency with the F value. Okay, so those are the points you should remember. Also remember these things. See, they will not give these conditions under 15 centimeter. That is for your knowledge, I'm telling. Who has given that? It is given by IRC. IRC has given one more term. See, just imagine you're riding your vehicle. Your brain is taking some time. Will it be the same time my brain is taking? Definitely not. Maybe some fresh driver is there. Maybe some experienced driver is there. Definitely the value of reaction time is going to change, right? This part. So they will give some values in the question. Whatever value they are giving, take as it is. In case if they are not giving, we have to take a value of T. What is that time? T is nothing but 2.5 seconds. As per PIEV theory, IRC has given a reaction time of 2.5 seconds. Same is the case if they are giving some value, 3 seconds, 2 seconds, 2.4 seconds, 2.8 seconds, 5 seconds, take as it is. In case if they are not given, then take 2.5 seconds. This itself is a previous gate question for 1 mark. I'm going to tell you one more interesting thing. They have asked a 2 marks question from this concept. You want to know what is that? What is the equation for braking distance on a gradient? 4 options were there. V square by 2GF, V square by 2GF plus N by 100, V by 2GF, F, something like that. So some values they have given. Simply the equation they have given for 2 marks from this particular thing. Okay, so anywhere you can get the value. Which one you are asking, which is maximum or minimum? This is actually an average value. If an ideal driver, maybe someone is having good experience, he may be taking only 1 second or 1.2 seconds or maybe something less than that, because his brain is having enough experience on the road, so he can make decisions fast. Or he's a good driver, means while driving he's concentrating only on driving. Suppose some other drivers, he's not a good driver, he may be thinking something else. Maybe you might have watched some movie, you may be thinking some scenes of the movie, and you're driving, definitely is going to affect you. So you'll get some more time, 6 seconds, 7 seconds. See, that's why accidents are happening sometimes, right? The drivers are not able to apply the brakes fast because his brain is taking more time, because He may be thinking something else. He may be tensed something. Okay. So this is actually an average value, 2.5 seconds as per IRC. Okay. If not given, then only take it is. If they're giving some value, take as it is. Okay. So I'm going to give you one question. Remember, this should be in meter per second. If not given, then only 2.5 seconds and the remaining values. This should be coefficient of longitudinal friction. Whatever value they are going to give, take as it is. They will be giving the values, okay? Because it is in the range, no? There is no particular value. So they will be giving the range and all. So take down a question. I'm going to give you some question. Okay, I'll be writing the things here while I'm reading. Right. So yeah, only a few minutes we are having now, right? No problem. Just write simple questions. Take the first question. Calculate the safe stopping sight distance on a level road. Use some short words only. Calculate the safe stopping sight distance on a level road for a design speed of 60 km per hour. For a design speed of 60 km per hour. Okay. See, what do you mean by design speed? Design speed is nothing but the speed at which the road is designed. That's it. So the vehicle may be coming at the design speed or less than that. Our intention is the vehicles should be coming less than design speed. Okay. But simply, if they are giving the design speed, instead of giving the speed of the vehicle, we'll be taking as the speed of the vehicle. Okay. So design speed is 60. So calculate the SSD on a level road for design speed 60 km per hour. And question mark in the bracket, you can write, assume the coefficient of friction is equal to 0.36. Coefficient of friction is 0.36. So calculate the stopping sight distance. Do fast. If they are asking such a question, definitely it will be for 2 marks. Okay. Many times they have asked the question. So you can practice those previous questions also. Some questions we'll be solving here also. Same type of question they will be asking for 2 marks. So in this case, they have not given the reaction time. Then what you have to do? You have to take it as 2.5 seconds because IRC told if you're not having the value, take this value. Very good, Devashish. That speed is required for us for the gate examination. What I have to do? First, we have to convert into meter per second. How to convert KMPH into meter per second? You have to multiply by 5 by 18 or you have to divide by 3.6. This 18 by 5 is nothing but 3.6. So you have to divide by 3.6. So it will be 60 by 3.6 into 2.5 plus 60 by 3.6 square divided by 2 into 9.81 into 0.36. How much it is? Approximately some 81 meter you are getting now. So depends, maybe. Yeah, very good, very good. So you may be getting options sometimes, or they will give round off to one decimal and all. Then you can write that whatever you are exactly getting, there will be some range, some 80.1 to 81.1, something like that they may be giving. No, it is 81 point something you're getting. So accordingly, a proper range they will be giving. Okay, very good. So that is a simple question. Many times they have asked such a very minute, simple question. Many times, okay? That too for 2 marks. Either for 1 mark also, sometimes they used to ask. Okay, now take the next question. Right, a decreasing gradient of 3%, is present on a road of design speed 80 km/h. A 3% decreasing gradient is there, where speed of the road is 80 km/h per hour. Okay. For a driver with a reaction time, for a driver with a reaction time, 2.3 seconds. For a driver with a reaction time, 2.3 seconds. What will be the safe stopping sight distance? What will be the safe stopping sight distance? In bracket, assume coefficient of friction is equal to 0.35. See, what is this 0.25? It is nothing but coefficient of 0.35, coefficient of longitudinal friction. Generally, reaction time 2.5 seconds. Yeah. Why? Because they are not giving the value in the question. In case if they are giving, take as it is. Most of the time, they may not be giving because they are giving you 2 marks for this calculation. No? So you have to remember that 2.5. Just for remembering that 2.5 also, they are giving some marks. That's why. Okay, it will be approximately some 130 meter. Very good, Devashish. Better take, always take the accurate value. So it will be Vt plus V square divided by 2GF minus N percentage by 100 because it is a decreasing gradient. Yeah, everyone do it and tell me the answer. So first you have to calculate into 80 divided by 3.6. See, better you use this 3.6 because don't try to convert that. See, if you're converting 80, it will be around some 22, I guess, some 22.2 meter per second you may be getting. So if you're taking that simply 22.2 or 22.22, and if instead of you're taking 80 by 3.6, you're going to get the precise value, accurate value you're going to get. Okay, so better take something like this. So 2.3 plus 80 by 3.6 whole square divided by 2 into 9.81. What is the value of F? 0.35. So from 0.35, we are going to minus how much? 0.03. Because they have given it's a decreasing gradient. Very good. I ignored the decimal value. Better don't ignore the decimal values. Okay, always take the accurate value because we don't know, right? What will be, see, if the options are there, it's fine. For numerical answer type question, if it is there, better whatever they are going to ask, give as it is. And one more thing, see, if you are taking simply 22 instead of 22.22 and all, here you are going to use it, here you're going to square it. So some change may be happening between 130, someone is getting 129, something like that happen. No? So you may be getting some 131 point something. So better take accurate value. So approximately everyone is getting some 130 meter approximately. Sure, Kardo, it's good class. Yeah, thank you, Sunil. Thank you. Okay, so this is what. Now, one important parameter is there. One twist they can make. I forgot to tell you that. See, in this case, I hope you got this answer 130. See, in this case, in this level road case or whatever be the case, suppose generally for level road case only that is there. See, this is in one direction, right? There is a special case of a single lane two-way road. For a single lane two-way road. Okay. For a single lane two-way road, what is actually happening? See, you are going to stop your vehicle, which means you need some SSD. Single lane two-way, what it means? A vehicle is coming in the opposite direction also. So for that guy, if he is not able to stop here, what happens? He is going to come and hit you, right? Very good. So he is going to come and hit you. Then to be safe, you require one more. So actually the safe stopping sight distance is what? SSD1 plus SSD2. A vehicle is coming in the next from the opposite direction also. So for a single lane two-way road, we generally take it as 2 times stopping sight distance. Why is 2 times stopping sight distance? Why? Because you need some particular distance. See, what was the value of that first question? Some 81 meter you got, no? Approximately some 81 meter. So if you're having some 81 meter, yes, you are safe. You can stop and you will be safe. Suppose that is a two-lane road. Means another guy is also coming. We are assuming same speed. Another guy is also coming from the opposite side. What if that guy is not stopping? You are stopping before obstruction, but he is coming and hitting you. Are you safe? Absolutely not. To be safe, how much distance you'd need? Your stopping side distance plus that guy's stopping side distance. So finally, what will be the value of stopping side distance? 2 times SSD. Understanding? You take the first question and from the same data, I'm asking you one more question. Suppose that was a single lane two-way traffic. For the first question, suppose I'm giving as another question. In the question three is what? In the first question, question one, suppose it was a single lane, two-way traffic. Single lane, two-way traffic. What will be the safe SSD? Or simply, if they are asking, stopping side distance also same. Okay, yeah, that's why I have written SSD 1 plus SSD 2 actually speaking. But if they are giving some value of the other vehicle, then we have to calculate SSD 1 plus SSD 2. But most of the time, if this is the condition, single lane, two way, they will not give the other vehicle's value. We have to assume both are same because we are assuming that this is coming at design speed, 80 kilometer per hour. What was the speed? First case, 60 kmph. Design speed means our maximum speed. So maximum that much. In the worst case, we are going to come in that maximum speed only. Okay, understood, Devashish? That's why we are taking it as 2 into SSD. If they're giving separate values, then calculate SSD and SSD 2 and add it. Okay, yeah, very good. So in the previous case, you got it as some 81 meter. So by default, if they are not telling anything regarding number of lanes, directions, by default, it's our general case, 81 meter. In case if they're giving something like this, don't make mistake, don't get deviated. See, 81 meter also, they may be giving in the options. So here we got 81 meter. So if it is a single lane, two way, we know we have to take 2 into SSD. Actually, it is SSD 1 plus SSD 2. But since they are not giving any other data, we are assuming it is same value of speed and all. So 2 into 81, 162 meter. Okay. So I hope you understood that twist also. In case if they are making some twist, don't make any mistake. Okay. So can I give you another question? Within some limited time, I'm going to give you another question. Okay. So I told you, suppose this case, some intermediate that I'm going to give you. Okay. See, always listen, always read the question carefully. It may not be always they are asking you the stopping side distance. Sometimes they can ask you what is the lag distance, or sometimes they can ask you what is the braking distance. Okay. So whatever they have asked, calculate it separately, then take the values. Okay. If they're asking stopping side distance, then only add it. Suppose they're asking only braking distance, we need only V square by 2GF like that. Okay. Yeah, for admission and all, you can call to that number. I've written a number there. You can call there online, offline, whatever. All the classes are available. You'll be getting offline classes. You'll be getting physical classes. You can just call to that number and ask your queries. Okay. And regarding other subjects, timetable also, you can contact and ask them. Fine. So I'm just going to give you a question, something like this. If they are making some twist, don't make mistake. So write a question. A vehicle is moving on a road of gradient plus 4%. A vehicle is moving on a gradient of plus 4%. What it indicates? It's an upward gradient. Okay. At a speed of 20 meter per second. So speed is given as 20 meter per second. So no need to convert now. They have already given meter per second. So 20 meter per second. Consider the coefficient of friction as 0.46. Coefficient of friction is how much? 0.46. See, I told you for design, we are taking from 0.35 to 0.4. I told you, in case if they are giving some other value, take as it is. Okay. So 0.46. One more word is there for this longitudinal friction. It is also called as rolling friction. Coefficient of longitudinal friction or coefficient of rolling friction. Both are same. Okay. So 0.46. And next sentence. What will be the braking distance of the car? What will be... Sorry. One second. Some mistake. So 0.46. And acceleration due to gravity. Acceleration due to gravity is 10 meter per second square. After f value, take g is equal to 10 meter per second square. Next sentence, on applying the brakes to reach at a speed of 10 meter per second, applying the brakes to reach a speed of 10 meter per second, the required braking distance in meter will be dash. What will be that distance? Required braking distance to reach from this 20 to 10 meter per second. You have to calculate in meters. Yeah, do it. So what equation you have to use? We have already studied. See, stopping side distance is Vt plus P square by 2G F plus N percentage by 100. But see, they are not asking the stopping side distance. They're simply asking what is this portion, right? We don't require this. So how to calculate this? I told you. Very good, Abhishek. If they are giving two values, what you have to do? V1 square minus V2 square. No need to remember the derivation and all. The derivation I have given. See, maybe after a few days or few months, if you're taking the formula and checking V1 minus V2 square and all, what is this? Don't feel confused. That's why I have given the derivation. Okay. Directly, you can use this equation now. So in this case, no need to convert because it is already given into. Very good. Why don't you check the calculation once again? Some minute mistakes may be there. I think you have again converted into meter per second and all. Okay. So it's already in meter per second. So 20 square minus 10 square divided by 2 into this thing, G, in which value you have to take? If they are giving 10, take 10. If you are taking 9.81, you are going to get something more value. Okay. So into what is the F value they have given? 0.46. So it is a plus, right? Already given it is plus, or it is an upward gradient of 4% means 0.04. How much you are going to get? Very good. Everyone is getting approximately 30 meters. Approximately 30 meters are you getting? Yeah, very good, John. Very good. Vishnu is getting good. Why don't check the solution? Maybe somewhere you made a calculation mistake. Okay, I hope now you're getting. So what about this question? Is an easy question or tough question? I will tell you, this is the toughest question asked from this concept for GATE exam. This is a GATE 19 question recently. Very recently, they asked the question. The previous questions which we have solved, same type of GATE questions asked. I have simply changed the value. See, we have used some 60 kmph. Instead of 60, they have asked some 70. That's it. So purposefully, I have not given the exact value of GATE question, because GATE question also you can practice and check whether you are getting the same value or not. I have just changed the values. So many times they have asked the question whether you need one more question. We can solve one more question, right, before winding up. Okay, another level of, or other way of asking question. Okay, I'm just going to give you one more question. So I told you, either they can ask you in the same of a plain level road what it is. If they are not giving you any gradient, which means by default it's a plain road. Okay, Vt plus V square by 2gf. Okay, and if they are giving, it's a single lane two-way road. In all other cases, general case, only if it is a single lane two-way, we have to multiply by 2. If they are giving two values, calculate separately and add it. Most often they will not be giving like that. So 2 into SSD. And if they are giving gradient, plus or minus, so that's it. If they are giving some twist like this, directly you have to calculate like this. Yeah, one more variety I'm going to give. So write the question. A vehicle is moving at a speed of 100 kilometer per hour. A vehicle is moving at a speed of 100 kilometer per hour. If the reaction time of the driver was found to be 2.45 seconds, if the reaction time of the driver was found to be 2.45 seconds, 2.45 seconds. Yeah, full stop. The reaction time of the driver was found to be 2.45 seconds. What will be the braking distance? What will be the braking distance? If the lag distance and braking distance are, what will be the braking distance if the lag distance and braking distance are in the ratio 4:6? If the lag distance and the braking distance are in the ratio 4:6. So this is given. And finally, what they are asking, what will be the braking distance? 4:6. So what will be the braking distance? Okay. So just see how to calculate that. Reaction time is given 2.45 seconds. And the lag to brake distance is given as 4:3, nothing but 4:6, nothing but 2:3, whatever. What it indicates, lag distance by brake distance equal to 4/6, or I can write it as 2/3, both are same. Hope you take transportation for new batch in Bangalore. Yeah, hopefully. We'll see. We are having a lot of good faculties. In fact, whoever is free will come to you for taking class. Or for those who are not able to take the physical classes, can take the offline class also. That is one of the important good thing which is going on in the Gate Academy. If you are working somewhere or if you are studying, you are not getting time to go for the physical classes, then you can go for the online class also. Online course is available. So you can call to that number 0804061100 for more information regarding the courses. Getting the answer for this question, are you getting confused? It's a tricky question. What is the answer for this? It's actually a simple question. You need only some 10 seconds to solve this. 102. Very good, Vishnu. See that speed and all, we don't. Yeah, very good. 102. No need to get confused and all from the given values. What they have given, speed is given, reaction time is given. See, suppose you might have been thinking that, what is the coefficient of friction and all. See, suppose the coefficient of friction is also given, let it be something. Don't get confused because of that. We don't require the coefficient of friction here, right? Yeah, very good. Varun, very good. What is the lag distance? V into T. What is lag distance? So 100 divided by 3.6 into 2.45. How much is this lag distance? 100 by 3.6. So you will be getting some 68.05. This is, I guess. Right now? Yeah, good. Abhishek, good. So this thing we have already got. Then what will be the braking distance? If you're taking braking distance here, that will be lag distance by 2/3. Or I can write it as 68.05 into 3/2. How much you're getting? Some approximately 102 meter. Very good. So I hope others are also getting the answer, right? So in case if they're giving some coefficient of friction value, don't get confused from the given values, or don't think that array they have not given the friction value, how we are going to calculate. Okay. So these are the varieties of questions they might have asked. Yeah, I told you, 2001 gate question was, what is the equation for braking distance for an upward gradient of G? If the upward gradient is G, what is the braking distance? Options were V square by 2G F plus G, V square by 2G F minus G, V by 2G F plus G, V by 2G F minus G. What is that? V square by 2G F plus G. G is nothing but our decimal value. I already told you for how much marks they asked this. For 2 marks, simply the equation, not even the calculation. So that's why I'm telling the concept or the subjects, transportation engineering is simple and more or less it's a beautiful subject. Easily you're going to get the score. Just imagine if you want to get 2 marks from some other subjects, just imagine how much effort you are putting. compare. Yes, definitely you have to put some efforts for all the subjects to get a good score and to get into IITs or ISE or get into PSUs. Definitely you have to struggle a lot. Now you have to struggle something. Later, you will be getting the fruitful result, right? While struggling, you just have to struggle a little bit compared to other subjects for this particular subject, okay? So today we are winding up this session. So from the next session onwards, tomorrow at the same timing, you will be getting from 11 to 1 p.m., you will be getting the same timing. You will be getting the remaining portions of geometry design. So we'll be discussing the overtaking sight distance, in which all portions they can make some twist. And we'll be seeing some other concepts like horizontal curve and all. Okay, so we are winding up today's session. If you're having any doubt for today's session, you can ask me. We'll be discussing now. Any doubt, or you can, how was the class, or should we do anything more or less? Yeah, that's one of the important thing. Just share the link with your friends also. And if you are sharing with your friends, don't think that, hey, he will also listen, he will also get the marks. Don't think that. If you're sharing, you're doing some good thing, finally the God will give you the result. Okay, you will be getting some good marks if you're helping others also. Okay, so share the link with your friends, and the timetable of the remaining sessions, everything you'll be getting. So subscribe the channel and click on the bell icon so that you'll be getting the instant notifications. Okay, you will not be missing. Sharing is caring. Absolutely, Abhishek. That's it. If you're caring others, definitely the Almighty will care about you also. Okay, so share with your friends and go through the things. And yes, regarding overtaking sight distance, I've already done a video. It is available in our channel regarding the minimum overtaking sight distance. You can go through that for better clarity so that in the next session tomorrow, you'll be easily able to solve the questions. Okay, so there is already a video available on minimum overtaking sight distance in the Gate Academy channel. Go through that. It has taken by me only. So you can go through that. It may be a 1 hour session. Go through that. You'll be easily getting whatever things we are going to discuss in the next class. Okay, so thank you, John, for your comment. So we are winding up today's session. Thank you. Thank you so much. Don't forget to subscribe the channel and don't forget to click on the bell icon so that you will not be missing any classes. You will be getting the notification whenever there is a class, okay, whatever be the subject. So thank you. Thank you so much for attending the class. Bye. See you tomorrow. Take care.